what impresses me is he had a joint appointment until his retirement from the departments of physiology, math, and physics. He has over, he didn't know, I'm surprised, but I look at his publication, over 300 publications. So now he was taught that it's too long for me to read. You can read it.
City, I probably would have said no to the invitation. But since I haven't actually spent much time in Kansas City since 1963, which was a while ago, when I went to graduate school, I thought it'd be nice to come back and see what was going on. And some of it looks the same, some of it looks quite different. And I see that you start mathematicians off at a very early age here in Kansas City. So, I decided I wanted to tell you about something that has been my passion for years. And it has to do with really understanding how the human body produces blood cells. And lately, we've gotten interested in not only how understanding, using that understanding of how the human body produces blood cells, we've gotten interested in trying to use that knowledge to understand how we could actually treat diseases involving that production. And I think even more importantly, understanding how to avoid side effects on that production system resulting from chemotherapy. The latter is much more important in my estimation based on the number of people affected. And it's something that I'm pretty passionate about. And so I'm happy to have the chance to tell you about some of the things that we've done over the years and some of the things that have worked and some of the things that haven't worked. And then you can be the judge for yourself about what we're doing really makes sense and whether it's worthwhile. So I just want to give you a bit of an outline about where I'm going to go in the next 45 minutes to an hour. And I have to say, if you have a question, please feel free to interrupt. Don't be shy. I love questions. The one thing I will tell you is if you ask me a question, please speak up clearly and loudly because I am somewhat deaf, or as my wife says, very deaf. But regardless of what adjective you use, I am deaf, and I have hearing aids, so it will help. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about what we call periodic and dynamical diseases, and then tell you some general things that you probably learn in high school biology about how blood cells are produced, and then talk about a specific kind of disease that we've spent a lot of time trying to understand. It's called cyclical neutropenia. And if you don't understand the words, they'll become very clear as the talk goes on. And then how you can actually use mathematical modeling to figure out good ways to treat cyclical neutropenia. And then finally, I'm going to turn to the third part, the chemotherapy part, and tell you about some things that we've learned from the modeling about how to best treat some of the side effects of chemotherapy. A periodic disease is something, is a disease in which something that's normally periodic, or not normally periodic, becomes periodic, or maybe it's periodic and it changes its periodicity. And I put four examples here drawn from hematology. In the upper left, right here, doesn't show up very well. This is autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Physicians love long complicated names for things. And all it means is that the red cell count is oscillating, and it's due to the body attacking its own red blood cells, producing hemolysis, and thereby producing an anemia. In this particular patient, we're getting a really wonderful oscillation in red cell count over a period of like 130 days. Very pronounced. Yep. The upper right is a disease involving only the platelets. So here we have only the red cells being affected. Here are the platelets. And it's called cyclical thrombocytopenia, meaning the thrombocytes or the platelets go from normal to low and back up again. And again, we don't have as much data for this particular patient, but you can see it's a pretty clear oscillation. And then in the lower left, cyclical neutropenia, which I'm going to spend quite a bit of time talking about, it doesn't just involve one kind of blood cell, it involves all of them. And what you see are oscillations in the neutrophils, where they go from normal down to zero, essentially, and then back up again, down, up, and down. There's also an oscillation in the platelets and an oscillation in the red cells. And finally, on the right, there's a case of so-called periodic chronic myelogenous leukemia. This young woman has a very pronounced oscillation in her white cell count. And notice that the white cell count is oscillating around an increasing baseline over almost a 300-plus-day period. The platelets are also oscillating, and the red cells are oscillating. So these are four examples of so-called periodic hematological diseases. And hematology, it turns out, is full of examples of these. They are relatively rare, but they tell us a great deal about the system. And in terms of actually trying to understand what's going on, it's good to recall a few basic facts. So the three major cell types, three major blood cell types that we produce are white cells, red cells, and platelets. And on the left, there's a light micrograph of all three of these guys in this slide. This is the red cell right here, the so-called biconcave disc. And just to aid identification, it has an R on it. There's a platelet right here, the P, and this is the white cell right here. So the red cells carry oxygen to your tissues. The white cells are involved in fighting off infection, and the platelets are involved in clotting mechanisms. If you don't have any platelets, you can't clot properly, you end up with bruising all over the place. If you cut yourself, you know, it's very difficult to actually stop the bleeding, etc. Now, the interesting thing about the hematological system is that the production is absolutely astronomical. If you pick up a hematology textbook, they talk about 10 to the 12 cells per kilogram of body weight per day, and nobody has a clue what that means. You know, it's like Prime Minister Trudeau in Canada talking about the national debt in Canada. Nobody can really comprehend what it actually means. But if you actually translate that into something you can relate to, the production of red cells is 500 kilograms over your lifetime. And remember, I know you don't use kilos here, but a kilo is 2.2 pounds. That's a lot of red cells. 160 kilos of white cells and 30 kilos of platelets. So that means if you add it all up, that each and every one of us is producing approximately your body weight in blood cells every 10 years of life. That's astounding. And the astounding thing is it takes place in almost everybody without a mistake. You know, it's very unlikely that anybody in this room will actually die from a hematological disease. Far more likely to die from a heart attack or a stroke or one of a variety of various tumors. Hematological diseases are extremely rare because the mechanisms controlling blood cell production are very finely tuned to eliminate abnormal cells. And as a consequence, the hematological system is an ideal place to actually study the regulation and control of cell proliferation and cell maturation. Now, if you want to try to look at the production regulation, this is sort of an engineer's schematic diagram of what's going on. So in our bone marrow, primarily, we have a population of stem cells. And these stem cells are capable of producing either red cells, white cells, or platelets. So they're undifferentiated cells. And there's, you know, they can be divided into cells going through DNA synthesis and cells in the G0 phase, or the resting phase between mitotic events. And these cells can differentiate into either neutrophils, red cells, or platelets. And each of these different differentiation pathways has essentially the same general kind of regulation involved. So for example, in the platelets, the total platelet mass in the circulation is sensed, and it controls the level of a hormone called thrombopoietin that feeds back and regulates the input of cells into the slide. Same is true for red cells, same is true for neutrophils. And it's a negative feedback. So for mathematicians, it means that if the output goes up, the feedback shuts off the input. But the other thing that's important, crucially important in terms of trying to understand the regulatory process, is that this feedback involves delays. And there's a significant delay between the input of the platelet precursor and when you actually get a platelet out in the circulation. It's on the order of a week, order of magnitude. Now, from a mathematical perspective, these delays are particularly interesting because they are not constant. They are state dependent. They depend upon the state of the system. There's not a unique delay for the entire system, but rather there's a distribution of delays. So there's a whole host of interesting mathematical problems, none of which I'm going to talk about today, at least in this lecture. So if we want to try to understand something about what's going on, let's try to think about cyclical leukemia. And here, the first thing that usually is the tip-off for a physician is that a patient will show up and they'll say, you know, doctor, there's something really weird. I'm getting cold every 3 weeks, or every 3 weeks I'm getting some kind of sores in my mouth, or every 3 weeks, you know, I'm getting something that's like the flu. Now, it takes a perceptive patient to note this. You know, they have to be aware of the fact that they're getting sick every 3 weeks. And when the doctor checks, when they actually start doing blood cell counts over a period of time, they'll oftentimes discover that this patient has neutrophil levels that are cycling from normal to low levels. And here's a good example on the left. There's a patient here on the left, and this is a so-called normal person. This is actually, these are data taken from my colleague David Dale in Seattle, who treated this patient back in the 1970s at the NIH. And Mrs. H, who was patient one, was at the clinical center at the NIH in Bethesda, and what they found was that her white cell count was going from normal to zero, back up to normal, back down to zero. And when the white cell count's down at this level here, she ends up getting a cold every 3 weeks. So they studied her over a period of over 200 days, and what they discovered was, and this, by the way, is what the normal count looks like. It looks noisy around the baseline. And if you actually look at the monocytes, lymphocytes, which are variants of the neutrophils, you see all reticulocytes, which are precursors for the erythrocytes. And if you actually do a Fourier spectral analysis of those data, what you find on the right is that the neutrophil has a very prominent, the neutrophil level has a very prominent statistically significant peak in the power at the frequency corresponding to about 20 days. And the same is true for the lymphocytes with another non-significant peak out here. The monocytes, the platelets, very interesting because the two significant peaks are not at the same frequency. It's the only patient we've ever seen this in. We don't know why. And finally, for the reticulocytes, the red cell precursors, again, you see this very prominent peak corresponding to a period of about 20 days. Now, in terms of trying to understand what was going on in cyclical neutropenia, we got hold of clinical data from the pharmaceutical company Amgen. Amgen was doing a clinical trial on neutropenic patients, and we got the data for 45 of those patients. And we had developed a model based on that engineering schematic diagram. And we asked the following. We estimate the parameters for what we think is a hematologically normal person. Then we take the model in conjunction with the data for each of these 45 neutropenic patients. And we ask, what do we have to change to actually make the model produce the data that we see in the cyclical neutropenia patient? So what we're doing is we've got a large model with a lot of parameters, and we say, what do we have to change? Well, it's pretty interesting because for all 45 patients, we found that we had to change only two parameters in order to get a best fit between the model and the patient data. We had to assume that there was an elevated level of apoptosis, an elevated level of cell death in the neutrophil precursors, and we had to assume there was an alteration in the feedback in the stem cell compartment between quiescent cells and cells going through DNA synthesis. And it was consistent in all 45 patients. Those were the only two parameters that had to be changed in order to produce the kind of variation we saw in the clinical data. Now, the reason Amgen did this study was that they were trying to market, they were trying to convince the FDA to allow them to market a synthetic version of the hormone that controls neutrophil production. And it's called granulocyte colony stimulating factor, or GCSF for short. So Amgen was not doing this out of the generosity of their heart. They were doing it in order to get their drug approved for clinical use. And so what they did was, in the clinical trial, they took all 45 patients after they had studied them for a period of months, and then they put them on GCSF. So we also had those data. So basically what we did was we took the model, we took the parameters that were required to produce the data set for each of the 45 patients, and then we said, okay, what do we have to do to the model with those altered parameters to reproduce the results of giving them GCSF? So, now in treating, we know that, clinically, we know that what happens is, if you give GCSF, it decreases the period of the oscillation, and it makes the amplitude of the oscillation higher, but most importantly, it decreases the minimal value of the oscillation in the neutrophils, which means the neutrophil count goes to a minimum that's higher than normal. And it's high enough that they don't end up getting symptoms anymore. They don't get sick. The problem is it's expensive. And our modeling predictions predicted that apoptosis should be the culprit. And we knew exactly what the modeling predicted in terms of the effects. It turns out to mimic exactly what was seen clinically. And so when we actually carried out that experiment that I just described, what we found was we knew that the red circles marked the places where the alterations were predicted to be based on the clinical data. And we give GCSF to the model, and it turns out the two places that are affected are, again, the rate of apoptosis and the neutrophil precursors, and secondly, a differentiation rate of the quiescent cells into the neutrophil line. So we felt pretty confident that we had a relatively good model for the regulation of neutrophil production. Now the question is, how could you actually go about avoiding this? The problem we face is, can we use this model to avoid problems involving the application of chemotherapy? And my claim is yes. Now, in most patients that are receiving chemotherapy, how many people in the room have ever had chemotherapy? None, you're too young. How many people in the room have had a family member or a friend receive chemotherapy? Yeah. If you've been close to the person getting chemotherapy, you'll know that the effects can be pretty devastating. And the question is, can we actually use the mathematical modeling in an intelligent way to make the delivery of chemotherapy less devastating? One of the most devastating side effects is that the patients become neutropenic. Their white cell count gets to be extremely low. They end up with an infection or with pneumonia or something, and the chemotherapy has to be terminated for a period of time. Some patients don't develop neutropenia, but rather develop low platelet counts, or they become anemic because they don't have enough red cells. So the question is, can we actually use the mathematics to figure out a better way to do it? And that's the question, and I think the answer will become relatively obvious. So the vast majority of protocols for delivering chemotherapy call for it to be delivered periodically. So in Canada, there are, I don't know about here, but in Canada, there are two major protocols that are used, for example, in the treatment of breast cancer, one of the most common forms of tumors, particularly among, obviously, women, and also uterine cancer. And that involves giving chemotherapy at a period of around 3 weeks. Not about, but they like to have it every 3 weeks. So we take the model that's been developed, trying to understand normal neutrophil production, and which we use to actually understand the onset of cyclical neutropenia, and we say, okay, suppose we actually give chemotherapy to the model every so many days. And we look and see what the amplitude of the white cell count is induced by the neutropenia as a function of the period between application of the chemotherapy. So to be totally clear, suppose we're giving chemotherapy every 10 days, then the amplitude, there's not much of an oscillation at all in the white cell count. And the low point will be at this point right here. Now the thing that's completely astonishing is that what we discovered was that there's a huge peak in the amplitude of the oscillation in the neutrophil count if you give chemotherapy at this period right here, which is virtually dead on to 3 weeks, 21 days. And then it very rapidly falls off as you go beyond that. And if you look at the low point in the neutrophil count, what you find is that during that period, it falls below the level corresponding to severe neutropenia. So what's happening here is that there's a resonance this is a nonlinear system, it has delays in it, and by giving, by forcing the system every 3 weeks, you're causing a resonance phenomenon. And you can see here on the right exactly what's going on, because here's neutrophil counts versus time, and if you give chemotherapy with a period of 18 days, that's the red line, what you see is the predicted neutrophil count oscillates because of the forcing, but it never goes below the neutropenic level, which is right here. If you, however, if you shift and give it every 21 days, by about the sixth or seventh cycle, you're starting to develop severe neutropenia. So this is very interesting. What it says is we should really adjust the clinical protocols to avoid that resonant period. Now, could we actually minimize the neutropenia? Well, if we could avoid the resonant period of neutrophils, the answer is yes. And we estimate that to be about 21 days. But it would be best to actually be able to estimate that for a given individual patient. And the question is, how could you possibly estimate what the resonant period is? Well, it turns out that by doing some analysis, we discovered what the resonant period was, and it's about 2 times the neutrophil lifetime. This is based on a linear analysis. So if we can just avoid that window where the resonance occurs, then we could actually, in theory at least, reduce the neutropenia that has actually occasioned by that chemotherapy. How do you do that? Well, it turns out to be deadly simple, because what you do is you have the patient drink about a liter of heavy water, which is deuterium oxide. Mm-hmm. It's completely harmless. It will not harm you at all. And it labels neutrophils during the proliferative phase, and all you have to do is start sampling for peripheral neutrophils that are labeled, and by getting the labeled neutrophil count as a function of time, you can estimate precisely what the transit time of the neutrophils is from commitment at the earliest stage to the point where they're released into the bloodstream. You multiply that figure by 2 for each patient, that will give you the resonant period, and then you avoid that in terms of chemotherapy. Now, hematologists and oncologists know very well that they induce neutropenia by giving chemotherapy periodically. So, in order to actually avoid the problem, instead of changing the period of administration, what they will do is they'll actually give G-CSF. That's the cytokine that controls white cell apoptosis in the precursor. So they give G-CSF. But there are highly variable effects depending upon when it's given, and nobody seems to have a clear idea why. So here's an explanation based on the model. So what we do is we set the model up so that we're giving chemotherapy every 21 days. So we're inducing a nice resonance oscillation in the system. And then we say, okay, if we give G-CSF to the model, what's the effect of the low point of the cycle, the low point of the cycle? Well, it turns out that if you give G-CSF, if you start up to about day 7 after chemotherapy, so chemotherapy is here, that's the dose administration. And if you give G-CSF up to that day 7, 1 week later, what happens is you actually increase the low point, okay? And turns out the best time to give it is about day 5. So if you start G-CSF on day 5, then you actually can increase the lowest point in the neutrophil cycle. You can avoid the neutropenia. On the other hand, if you start after a week of the chemotherapy, look what happens out here at day 14 and 15. It makes it much worse. So actually giving the so-called therapy 2 weeks after the chemotherapy, it makes it makes the situation worse than if you've done absolutely nothing. And here's a good example. So we set this up so that we're giving chemotherapy every 21 days. We give GCSF on day 5, and what happens is we don't ever develop neutropenia. If you gave it on day 15, which actually happens to be one of the protocols that is used, it makes the neutropenia worse. So I think this is a clear example of how modeling can actually potentially eliminate clinical practice. So we know that chemotherapy timing can be adjusted to minimize the side effects of chemotherapy time can be adjusted to minimize the side effects of the chemotherapy. And we also know that in terms of trying to alleviate the side effects of the chemotherapy, that when you actually give GCSF, it can have a very profound effect in terms of trying to modify these effects. Now, you would think that armed with this information, it would be extremely easy to convince the clinical community to actually change what they're doing. At least that's what I naively thought several years ago. That's not the case. And it's not the case, actually, for a very good reason. Because these clinical protocols are set up based on clinical trials. The clinical trials are funded by drug companies. They are incredibly expensive. And it's based on the results of the clinical trials that the FDA actually approves a particular protocol. So you know, the view of some naive mathematician like myself, that you can just change it willy-nilly is completely false. You can't change it. If physicians and hospitals don't follow the protocol, number one, they are open to lawsuits, which I think is particularly true here in the United States. It seems like there are a lot of lawyers and not enough business. And secondly, they can also be sued if the patient dies, you know, because the family can say, well, you deviated from the protocol, and if you had stuck to the protocol, my father, my mother, my sister, my aunt, whatever, would still be alive. And of course, that cannot be proved or disproved. So actually changing the system is extremely difficult, very difficult indeed. So here's what our current model predicts compared to some data. The data that we're looking at here was collected in Germany by a large clinical trial for the treatment of lymphoma in elderly patients. Okay. There were several hundred patients in this clinical trial, and blood samples were collected over a very fine time frame, much better than we usually have access to. And what you see is, on the one hand, the black band is the top 25% quartile, the blue band is the middle 50%, and then the bottom in the gray is the lowest 25%. And what you see here is the purple line is the prediction of our latest version of the neutrophil regulatory model. When we give it chemotherapy at the same period that the lymphoma therapy was being given, and the so-called CHOP protocol, also employed the use of GCSF. So they were giving chemotherapy as well as GCSF, and they were giving the GCSF 4 to 5 days after each dose of chemotherapy. So what we did was we took the model that we had, we made absolutely no changes in the parameters. We're not fitting the data. We simply took the model for a normal, hematopoietically normal human being, and we started giving a chemotherapy and GCSF exactly according to the protocol the Germans had used. And the result is the purple line, and I think I can say, and I hope you would agree with me, that the fit is pretty darn good. The prediction is pretty good. So we think that we have actually probably at this point the best existing model for regulation of human neutrophil production that exists, and what we're trying to do is figure out how we can get physicians to actually use this in a meaningful way. Now, since I told you it was virtually impossible to actually get physicians and hospitals to change what they're doing in terms of protocols, in Canada we have an advantage because our healthcare is state run. We have what politicians here like to call socialized medicine, which is said with a very derisive tone of voice because it's supposed to be undermining our rights. But the fact that we have state-run health care, which we all pay for in our taxes, means that the provincial health boards are very interested in everything that they can do to actually decrease health care costs. So what we're doing now is we're going, instead of going to the medical community, we're going to the health boards. And we're saying, look, you've got a lot, we're treating a lot of patients here in the province of Quebec for breast cancer, for uterine cancer, for this, for that. And it's costing you a lot of money because most of these patients become neutropenic. And then you've got physicians using, giving GCSF. Every time you give GCSF, it costs about $100. Not trivial. And we're telling health people, we think that if you actually try changing the protocols, we can help you decrease the healthcare costs. So that's the tack we're trying to take now to see if we can actually make it work. Because we've had zero luck, zero traction with the medical community. They think it's interesting, they think it's fascinating, and they say, sorry, we can't do anything. So now we're going to the source of the money to see if we can do something there. Because we estimate that we could save, in the province of Quebec alone, approximately $1 million Canadian dollars per year if we could actually avoid the side effects of chemotherapy in something like 3 out of 4 patients. So, there have been a number of collaborators in this. Some of the names will be familiar to some of the people here. Jacques Belair in particular, Tyler Cassidy and Morgan Craig are students of mine. David Dale, Tony Humphreys is a mathematician who's collaborating on this. Joseph Mahaffey is also another mathematician. Fahima Necca is a pharmacologist and mathematician. And Gabrielle Provence is a graduate student. And so I want to thank the Canadian government for the money that helped me do all this stuff. My collaborators, we've had a lot of fun over the years. And if you want to see the gory details about the model, then you can go to a paper that was simply just published in the Bulletin of Mathematical Biology. It came out 1 week ago, and you can go online to find it there. The first author is Morgan. So, thank you very much, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that people have because I ended 10 minutes early.
Any questions?
And I ended 10 minutes early because somehow about 8 slides have disappeared. I have no clue where they went. And I hope I covered it up successfully.
In your data, actually, how many patients were there?
I'm sorry, how many patients?
Yeah.
Between 300 and 400.
300 and 400?
Yeah.
And did you feed that or just... Did you feed actually more than to the data, or you actually just estimated
raw parameters?
Yeah.
It's raw data that was published by the German group. Mm. And we simply took it, digitized it, and then tried our model to see to what extent we could actually reproduce the data.
Oh, I see.
And when I saw the results, I was completely astonished. I thought, this is too good to be true.
Your model is simply like a system of ordinary differential equations?
No.
There are so many.
The model is a number of differential delay equations.
Oh, delay equations.
The model includes mature neutrophils in the circulation. It includes neutrophil precursors in the bone marrow. It includes stem cells in the bone marrow. It takes into account GCSF, pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. There are delays in the system. The delays are state dependent because we know that the maturation velocity of neutrophil precursors depends upon the GCSF concentration. We don't know the mechanism by which this is controlled, but we know empirically that it does depend on that. So there are state-dependent delays, differential delay equations, pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, and a lot of parameters. The parameters, we're getting a little bit better at estimating those things than we used to be. And I think we've got a pretty good handle on what the normal neutrophil production parameters are for an average human being. Now, one of the real problems in terms of doing modeling is the fact that for almost everything in human biology, we have no clue what the variation of the population is. You know, if you look at your blood pressure, people have a pretty good idea about what the variation across the population is for blood pressure. We know statistically some things, but we have no idea really about many, many physiological variables, to what extent they vary in the population. And this is a major problem. You know, we just simply haven't the data to actually estimate it. And this is one of the problems, I think, with all this hype that's been put about in terms of personalized medicine. I think it's baloney. You know, we're not going to have personalized medicine in my lifetime, and probably for most diseases, not in your lifetime either. And I think, you know, that's one of the big lies that I think the genomics project propagated in an effort to get more money, and they were very successful at getting the money. And so far, they've been pretty unsuccessful in terms of attempts at personalized medicine. Most of the patients that they've tried it on have ended up dying or getting worse. And I don't think that's going to happen for a while. And I think, in point of fact, if you have a slightly more modest goal in mind, like you wanted to be able to deal with somebody's reaction to chemotherapy, you know, spending $100 to have them drink heavy water and then getting blood cell samples over a period of 4 weeks sounds like a whole lot better investment to me than all this stuff in terms of genomic analysis and everything else, which has turned out to be so far spectacularly unsuccessful.
Mm-hmm. One more question?
Yes.
Yeah, you can go ahead.
Okay.
Two questions.
Remember, you have to speak up.
Sorry. I have two questions. One is, how is the chemotherapy incorporated into the model? And then the second is, The data was from lymphoma, and do you think that the findings will work across other types of cancer?
Okay, the way we incorporate the chemotherapy in the model is the following. Most chemotherapy works by interfering with DNA replication. And what happens is the chemotherapy molecule goes inside the cell, and during the transcription process of the DNA, it buggers things up in one way or another, maybe through methylation or a variety of things. Now, cells have a really nifty control mechanism for getting rid of things that have aberrant DNA, and it's called apoptosis. And we understand a fair amount about apoptosis. We don't understand everything. So the way in which the chemotherapy is incorporated in the model is to simply have it affecting cellular apoptosis in the proliferating precursor cells of the neutrophils. We also assume that it has a minor effect in the stem cells, but the minor effect in the stem cells is because of the fact that the cell cycle in the stem cells is so long. Stem cells very rarely go through DNA synthesis, so the number of stem cells affected by the chemotherapy is very small. The second part of your question is about the lymphoma data. Well, the people getting the chemotherapy treatment for the lymphoma are hematologically normal. They just have a lymphoma. And the lymphoma, of course, is most likely going to kill them because this is not something like Hodgkin's lymphoma that's relatively easily treated. So we know they're hematologically normal. So we assume that the model for a hematologically normal person works, and we just do exactly what I described. We have the chemotherapy affect the apoptosis process. And I think it should be widely applicable. I think it should work for a woman with breast cancer. They're also hematologically normal. Cervical cancer, hematologically normal. Somebody with colon cancer, hematologically normal. It should work. And the problem is actually getting enough data on a population of patients to actually figure out whether what I just said is correct. And the guy back there with the camera has a question.